time now for the news review of this bulletin. Iran's foreign minister urges the United States to stop using economic war as leverage. Negotiations held to salvage the 2015 nuclear deal. Mohammad Javad Zarif made the call in a telephone conversation with his British counterpart. He also stressed that Washington must fully return to its obligations under the nuclear accord, known as the JCPOA. Zarif said that he and the British foreign minister, Dominic Raab, have agreed on the necessity of resuming full compliance with the nuclear deal. The U.S. unilaterally pulled out of the deal in 2018 and reimposed sanctions on Iran, prompting remedial commitment cuts from Tehran. Iran and the remaining signatories are now engaged in talks to revive the accord. Iran has repeatedly emphasized that Washington has to take the first step by removing all the sanctions in a verifiable manner. Tim Anderson is the director of the Center for Counter-Hegemonic Studies, joining us from Sydney, and we also have Barry Grossman, who's a lawyer and peace activist, joining us from Bali for this. Barry Grossman, let me first start with you. The Iranian foreign minister telling the U.S. to stop using economic war as a leverage in negotiations. How do you think he means that?
Well, I think he means it exactly as stated. This isn't really rocket science. The United States dragged Iran to the table to negotiate a deal, then made a deal which the United States later, without reason, repudiated. And is now dragging its feet as the other signatories in Iran try and get things moving again. The U.S. priority is to continue waging this asymmetric warfare against Iran, which includes economic warfare and all sorts of other tactics, which are extremely unlikely to succeed, but are taking their toll. And meanwhile, as these talks in Europe continue among the P4 and Iran, the U.S. no longer being a party, the U.S. is sort of left in a position of lobbying its European allies, while tactically speaking, Iran has little choice but to try and win those European signatories over, that is, the United Kingdom, France, and Germany, which have long been very beholden to the United States. And as these talks move forward, of course, all the difficult issues have not yet been addressed. Even some of the parties, the negotiating parties that remain hopeful, are saying, look, there are a number of issues that have to be addressed that are political issues that haven't come up yet. And really, in many ways, we've got the sort of proverbial cart before the horse here. Ideally, the position stated by Iran is very simple and very contrary to the position publicly taken by Joseph Biden. Joseph Biden says Iran must comply first with its commitments under the JCPOA, then the U.S. will look at also complying, whereas Iran quite properly says, well, no, we honored the agreement until it was completely repudiated by the U.S. and European parties. So start complying with your obligations. We'll immediately show our willingness to comply with our obligations that arise as a result of everybody coming back to the deal. The U.S. obviously doesn't want to do that. Europeans are saying they expect a deal imminently. The Americans have just come out and said after the most recent fifth round talks that they expect there to be at least another sixth round and undoubtedly probably several more after that. So they're dragging their feet. The United States doesn't want a deal. It has a political football to juggle to keep the electorate happy, and in the meantime is entirely focused on lobbying the United Kingdom, France, and Germany to fall into line with the American position, bearing in mind that each of those countries is trying to stake out a position for themselves and win the prestige of being able to drive home a position which is acceptable to all the people they're accountable to.
Okay, well, Tim Anderson, how do you see it? Do you see this, I guess the talks, if they were to bear fruit, how do you foresee the future after that? I mean, I don't want to sit here and gamble with you as to whether there's going to be a deal or not, but I'm going to ask the question as to the way that this is going to affect the region, the geopolitics in the region, and how the U.S., along with its allies, will deal with Iran, were there to be a deal, let's say, if we were to speculate on that.
Yes, I think it is important to see the issue in a wider perspective, because at the moment, Mr. Grossman did a fairly good summary of the current position, and Iran is really in as a strong position to simply maintain its line. The US, for its part, has an intractable problem, because on the one hand, the Biden administration wants to return to some sort of accommodation there, but on the other hand, Washington generally is not capable of seeing itself lose leverage and lose the strategic influence that it sought to have through the JCPOA. And that's because the JCPOA was not really about nuclear weapons. It's really part of a wider new Middle East war that the US has been waging and losing on most fronts to try and dominate the whole region. And the agreement that they forced Iran into some years ago was really about trying to take Iran out as a major player in the region. So it's not really, and that's why you see them trying to add missile technology onto the nuclear agenda of the initial 2015 agreement. So in that context, I think it's very difficult for the US, but we have to see that much more is at stake, that the losing wars in Afghanistan, Iraq and Syria, for example, and Yemen, are also part of this big picture. And the US is, and Israel for that matter, are extremely paranoid and worried about the influence of Iran in the region. And that's what it's about. It's not really about any supposed mythical nuclear weapons that Iran is producing. They're more worried about their missile technology.
Barry Grossman, when you talk about the US, it seems like there are really two USs that are at the table. One is the administration, a pick for the team that's in Vienna, and then the other are like the hardliners maybe within the U.S. Congress, coming from the Republican side maybe, many of them, who are against this deal, and therefore they are going to do all they can to prevent it. Is that accurate, looking at it that way?
I think that's a point very well made. There's a tendency that people have to look at governments and entire nations as being monolithic, when in reality, the way things work is really very different from that. It's always important to stress, because so few people seem to understand this, that political parties, and indeed even governments, don't make policy anymore. But policy is crafted in largely privately funded think tanks with money coming from special interest groups, but overwhelmingly from corporate interests that have their own vested interests in play that they're trying to protect. And they give a very narrow range of options to the political apparatus, usually with quite clear instructions through the security apparatus to push a position, to push a particular position. I think the United States, along with Israel, are heavily invested in maintaining this asymmetric war against Iran, with some of the more extreme elements hoping for a more conventional fighting war to erupt as soon as possible. I don't see anyone in the United States, let alone in Israel, is having a real commitment to achieving some kind of a resolution. And we might as well say the same thing for the Saudi Arabia and the United Arab Emirates. They're all, as Tim Anderson just pointed out in court, quite committed to try and restrain Iran's influence and isolate it, but in many other ways heavily invested in maintaining this conflict with Iran, which is best understood, using the U.S. Neocon terminology, as being asymmetric, full-spectrum warfare. I don't believe that there's really anyone who's genuine in the United States about achieving any kind of a resolution, because it's certainly not in their interest as individuals, because they're paid to do something else. And in terms of the wider interests that are in play, they're quite committed to just about anything other than achieving an accommodation with Iran. So I don't hold out a great deal of hope. I think Iran has no choice but to follow the process through and see where it goes. There may be some chance to do a deal with the P4, but again, we saw what happened with that after the US pulled out of the P5 plus one agreement. All the assurances were given, and then the EU and European signatories, they did absolutely nothing to honor their commitments to Iran under the original deal. So it's all very complicated. It's a horribly outrageous and unreasonable and unacceptable. But of course, it is what it is. And I don't see any immediate relief in the near future. I do believe in the long run Iran will prevail, because ultimately we have to believe that the correct position prevails over the incorrect position. And I don't think there's any room for anyone who has even just a scintilla of understanding of the processes and the issues in play for arguing that Iran has done anything that's improper or that warrants the kind of response it's been getting from Atlantic world nations.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Barry Grossman, their lawyer and peace activist, and Tim Anderson, thank you, director of the Center for Counter-Hegemonic Studies from Sydney. And with that, we come to an end for this news review.